Hey there, Scott here. Your video is going to start in about 30 seconds. I just want to give you a little bit of context. The video you're about to watch is part of a series of educational videos. Some of them are taught by me, some of them are taught by other instructors. The goal here is to bring in experts who've excelled in their niche or their industry over their career and let them teach over to you whatever they specialize in. There's a variety of tools, technologies, walkthroughs, sales, marketing, business, startup, growth concepts, and ideas. Hopefully you can learn, and the whole goal of all of these videos is to help you level up in your personal or your professional life. Enjoy.
Hello guys, and welcome to the gaining access section. So all the attacks we did before in the pre-connection attack section, those attacks can be done without connecting to the internet or connecting to the Wi-Fi actually. So we don't know the Wi-Fi password, and we can still manage to capture the packets, and we can still read some information into them. But we cannot do a lot of stuff because all of that is encrypted. So what we are going to do in this section is trying to hack those Wi-Fi's. So we are going to gain the access actually, so we can do a lot of more stuff, because once we are on the network we can do a lot of stuff, and we can run even more powerful attacks by being the part of the network, and then it will be more easy for us to see the data which is being sent through the packets. And if it's an open network, I mean that if there is no encryption on those data packets, and you see that it is open network and it is not WEP, or it is not WPA or WPA2 or any other kind of encryption, so you can just skip these videos of the gaining access section, and you can just jump to the post connection attacks, because in this section we are only going to discuss how to hack Wi-Fi and how to gain access and how to break the keys and how to crack the keys and all that stuff. So if the network is using any kind of encryption, and it means that it is asking for a password, so it is asking for a decrypting password, so we need to hack it actually, and we need to do stuff by which we can actually capture the key or do some stuff to get into the network actually. So our sole purpose in this section is going to be part of becoming the part of the network. So there are actually three type of encryptions which are being used in Wi-Fi's, and these are followed all around the world. Number one is WEP. It is also called WEP, and it is not very widely used, but you can still find some Wi-Fi's or some networks using WEP. And then there is WPA and WPA2. WPA and WPA2 are kind of very similar, and all the attacks you can run on WPA, you can also run them on WPA2. So in the next section, we are going to discuss how we can hack into WEP and how to capture packets and how to generate IVs and all that stuff. First encryption we are going to break will be WEP. WEP is an old encryption, but you can still find some routers and some Wi-Fi networks using WEP. So we need to know that how we can actually crack WEP key. So WEP uses an algorithm which is called RC4, and how RC4 works is that one packet or every packet moving into the network is actually encrypted at the access point, and then it flies into the air and it goes to the client or goes to the device, and then it is decrypted at the client's end. The reason for that is it is decrypted on client's end is that because client has the key, and then when it enters the key, so the packet is decrypted and they can read the information in it. So WEP actually ensures that each packet which moves from the access point has a unique key. So and that unique key is a 24-bit initializing vector. So by the meaning of initialization vector, you can think of it as a random number. So a random 24-bit number is being sent with each and every packet, and that IV or that 24-bit random number is sent in the plain text. That random number is not encrypted by any algorithm like RC4 or any other encrypting algorithm. So that each packet contains some data, and then that packet has a random number attached to it, which is in plain text, so we can read it easily. So 24 bit is not a very large number. So what we are going to do is we are going to capture as many packets we can capture from the network, and then we are going to see those IVs. We are going to actually, and we are not going to see those IVs manually. There is a tool which is called AirCrackNG, and AirCrackNG is going to see those IVs and analyze them. So as in a busy network, we can have two packets with the similar random number actually. So it's like we can have two packets, and those two packets can contain similar IV, similar random number, because each and every packet is being sent with a random number, and then each packet has actually a unique random number, and we need to capture two packets with the same random, with same random numbers or same IVs actually. As I said, that 24 bit is not a very large number, and a network is sending thousands and millions of packets actually. So at one time it is going to send us the number which it sent to the last packet again, and we are going to capture so many packets that we can have the probability that we will find two packets with the same initialization vector. And then what AirCrackNG is going to do, it is going to actually crack those IVs or read those IVs, and then run statistical attacks on them, and then it will find the web key for us. Now that we know that in order to hack web key, we need to actually sniff as many packets as we can. So and we need to capture a lot of packets so we can get two packets with the same IVs or same random number on them. So we will be sniffing data using ArrowDumpNG, and ArrowDumpNG, we used ArrowDumpNG in the previous videos, and I told you that how we can actually target a specific AP or target a specific Wi-Fi we want to capture packets from. So in order to hack web, we are going to use ArrowDumpNG, and with ArrowDumpNG we are going to use AirCrackNG. So ArrowDumpNG will be capturing the packets, and what AirCrackNG will be going to do is that AirCrackNG will be trying to read those IVs. AirCrackNG will be trying to read those that 24 bit random number I told you about in the previous video, and it is going to run statistical attacks on it. It will be running statistical attacks on it, and then when it finds two packets with the same IV, so it will going to crack the web key for us. So ArrowDumpNG is very easy. We just need to put channel and then BSSID and then write the output, and using AirCrackNG is even more easy. We just type in AirCrackNG, and after that we're going to write this the file name. The file name is similar to this file name. It will be actually the file in which we are capturing the packets actually. So it is going to get more clear when we actually do it. So let's get into Kali, and I'm going to go to Terminator. Okay, so one thing we need to be clear about is if we are in monitor mode or not. So I am not in monitor mode, so I'm going to turn my monitor mode on. I'm going that again in front of you just because you guys have a revision of things and you know how all of this is done, so you don't have to go back. So we have monitor mode active in WLAN 0 mon. I'm going to clear it, and after that I can say do config, and here is the monitor mode is on. So now I am going to say error dump ng wlan 0 mon to check the Wi-Fi available for us, and here is our test network. This is the Wi-Fi we are trying to hack. This is the web network we are trying to hack or crack the key for. So now I'm going to start capturing the packets from this test network. So we write arrow dump ng, we write double dash b ssid, and I'm going to copy it from here. After that we specify the channel, and the channel is 1, and then we give it the output file name. So we can say it output web crack, or you can give it any name you want, and after that we are going to say wlan 0 mon. So it is very easy. Arrow dump ng, then bssid of the Wi-Fi or network we are trying to hack or crack the key, then channel, and then the name of output file, and then the interface monitor mode is running on. We press enter and it will start capturing packets from this test network. So now what we are going to do is we are going to run aircrack ng along with it. So it is very easy. We say aircrack ng, and after that we have to put the file name. So we say output webcrack.1.01 and then the capture file. So let me actually show you. These are the files we are actually, this is the file. So we have this file available. We can say aircrack ng, and after that we can copy it, or we can just type in output and then capture file. And what we're going to do is just press enter. So we press enter and it has now started to actually read those IVs and crack the key. So it is saying that it failed to find two packets with the similar IVs or similar random number. So it is going to try next on 5000 IVs. And you remember in the last videos we talked about that data is the number of useful packets we captured. So now it can get more clear to you that these are the packets with different kind of IVs. For example, we have captured 2700 packets right now, and each of those packets have a different IV. So we actually need an IV, or we need two packets with different IVs. So it is going to keep capturing those data packets and then keep comparing them. Aircrack ng will be comparing them, and arrow dump ng is actually capturing the packets. So, and it can take some time for there are two kind of web encryptions. One is 46-bit and another is 128-bit. So 128-bit can take a little longer, and if it is like a 46-bit, it can just happen and it will just crack the key in 15,000 IVs. But for 128-bit, it can go up to almost 50,000 IVs. And if a network is busy and a lot of people are using our test network, or for example, or the network we are trying to hack, so the data flowing in the network will be a lot, and it will be even a faster process. But if only one client is connected and he is not doing anything, or device is just sitting idle, so we will have to wait for the data packets to flow, because if someone is not doing anything on their device, so it means that no data packets are in the networks, and we need data packets. We need to capture thousands of data packets. For now, we are just going to wait and let aircrack ng do its thing, and in some time it is going to crack the key for us. So now we managed to actually crack the key, and you can see that this is the IV, and we have the password here, which is test password 1, and it took almost 1,80,000 IVs for the aircrack NG to crack it. So you just need to be patient to capture as much IVs you can, as much data packets you can, because hacking can actually get very hectic when you have to be very patient and you need to wait for things to happen. So sometimes it will happen for you in 10,000 IVs or 10,000 data packets, and sometimes it can take about 2 lakh or 3 lakh IVs too. So for me, it happened in almost 1,80,000 IVs, and now what I am going to do is I am going to turn off my monitor mode so I can check if I can connect with this network or not. So I'm going to stop monitor mode on my device, and yeah, I have WLAN 0 on manage mode. We can check from here, and yes, we are in manage mode. So let's see if we can connect to it or not. I actually got connected already, so I'm going to forget it and put the password again from here. So I go to settings, forget connection, and now what I'm going to do is I'm going to copy it from here. I can copy and then go back again here, and the Wi-Fi is not connected. I can click select network, then the test network. I will click on connect, and here I am going to paste it, and we click on connect, and it is saying, and now we are connected. So you can see that we got connected with the test network. With this key we found with aircrack ng, which is test password 1, and another thing that we only managed to do it just because we had two devices connected to the network, and there was a lot of data packets flowing, and we got to capture a lot of data packets, and then we found the IVs, and then aircrack did its thing. So, in the last videos we saw that how easy it is to crack the web key just by using aircrack ng and capturing as many packets as we can. But what if there is no device connected to the network, or there are no clients connected to the network? So how we are going to do it, because we need a lot of traffic and a lot of data packets flowing into the network so we can actually capture them, and then we can use them to crack the key. The problem arrives when there are no clients connected, or if there is a client connected, he is not doing anything, he is just sitting idle. So in that case, we need to actually inject packets ourselves into the network. So we need to inject the packets into the traffic and force the router to create new packets, and each and every packet will be stamped with a new IV actually. So we need to get those IVs, and we need to get that random number, and for that we need new packets. So let me show you an example of that here. So let's go to Kali, and here now we can see our test network here, and you can see that there is no data flowing, and there are no clients connected to it. So it means that it is just a network. It is broadcasting on channel 1, but this network is not connected to actually any client, or no one is using this network. So how we can actually try to hack it and try to get the key from it. So for that, we are going to use a method which is called fake authentication, and we are going to actually fake authenticate ourselves with the network. Because each router has a list of devices it is connected to, and if any device which is not connected to it tries to send packets to it, so the router will just going to ignore it. So router will ignore our packets if we don't authenticate ourselves with it. So we need to fake authenticate ourselves with the network, and for that we are going to use a tool which is called AirplayNG. We used AirplayNG when we wanted to run deauthentication attacks. So we are going to now run a fake authentication attack actually. So the method is very simple. We just say AirplayNG, then we write the type of attack, which is fake authentication. Then this is zero, the number of actually the time I want to authenticate myself. Then I put the target MAC address, actually the MAC address of the AP of the network I am trying to hack, and then my MAC address, and then I will tell it the interface which is actually running the monitor mode. So let's get into Kali and see how we do it. So here is our network, and it is not connected to any device. So we are going to fake authenticate ourselves. And another thing, you can see auth here, and once we have actually authenticated ourselves, it is going to show an OPN here, which means that it is it is changed to an open network after we actually fake authenticate ourselves. So now let's see how we can do it. So we can just say AirplayNG, and then we can write fake auth. And then you can say 0 or you can say 1. This is just the number of times I want to authenticate myself. So 0 actually means that I want to authenticate myself with only once. So I can say 0 or 1. It totally depends on you. Some people can put a large number and some just put a small number. So I'm just going to say 1 or 0. And after that, I'm going to say .a, and from here I can actually copy it. Then I write -h, and here I have to actually specify my IP, my MAC address, sorry. So I'm going to say ifconfig wlan0mon, and here the first six, the first 12 digits, the first six parts of this is my MAC address. So I'm going to copy it. Close it, paste it here. Then I'm going to put in colons instead of those dash. And you can see that a MAC address is a digit with like six parts. So I have same here. And after that, I just put in the interface of my monitor mode is actually running. So very easy, just AirplayNG, then we write fake authentication, and then the number of times I want to authenticate, -a, we have to specify the MAC address of our target. And after that, we need to specify our own MAC address, the MAC address we want to actually authenticate ourselves with, and then the interface. So we press enter, and now you can see that we are actually authenticated with the network, and it is saying OPN here. So it is an open network, and we are now fake authenticated with the network, and you can see that it is showing us here like we are connected to the network, but we are not actually connected to the network, but we are now allowed to actually insert the data packets into the network, so we can capture them and then we can crack them. And you can see that data was actually zero, but now Now, since our attack is running and we are authenticating ourselves, so the data packets are increasing. So in the next video, I'm going to tell you how we can actually increase this data number and how we can capture a lot of packets so we can break the IVs and get the network key. Authenticate ourselves with the network with the target API. What we need to do is we need to actually increase the data packets and inject the packets into the network so we can capture a lot of packets, and then we can use the packet the IVs on those packets to crack the web key using the aircrack ng. The method we are going to use it, or the attack we are going to use it, is called ARP, request replay. So once we have associated with the target API, we will wait for an ARP packet. ARP is a protocol which is used in the network. Actually, it is address resolution protocol, and how it works is that an ARP packet actually contains the IP address of the sender. So and it tells the router that I want to connect with you. ARP packet is a packet which contains the IP address of the sender, and it goes to the router and it tells the router that I want to connect with you. So you don't need to go into details. So we will wait for an ARP packet, and then we are going to capture that ARP packet. And after that, we are going to inject that ARP packet into the traffic. Once the ARP packet is injected into the traffic and it goes to the router, so router is going to generate a new packet with a new IV. And then we are going to capture that packet too, and we will reinsert it into the network, and we will send it again to the router, and router is going to actually generate a new packet. So it is like a chain, like we are going to run a fusion attack, and we are going to generate a lot of packets. We are going to make router actually to generate as many packets as we want, so we can capture those IVs, we can capture those packets and read the IVs and then crack the key. So it is very simple, but you just need to know how it is working in the background, and we don't need to do all of that manually. We are going to use a tool, AirPlay NG. We have been using it before, and it comes with many options, like we set it to fake authentication or deauthentication. So we are going to run the ARP replay attack with it. We can just write an AirPlay NG, then we can say ARP replay, and this is the type of attack we are running. Then dash B is the target MAC address, the MAC address of AP, and in dash H we are going to put our MAC address and then the interface. So let's get into Kali and see how it is done. So first of all, I'm going to run arrow dump ng against, and you can see that we are not connected to any network, any devices actually. So I want to actually capture those packets, so I'm going to give it a name of ARP replay packets, and I'm going to start running it, and then I'm going to fake authenticate myself using the same command I did, and press enter, and you can see that I am now authenticated with the network. So what I need to do now is I need to run the ARP replay attack. So I can say ARP replay, and then I specify the MAC address, and here is the MAC address of our target. Copy it, paste it here, then dash H, and I can check it using the same method we did it in the last video, ifconfig, and I'm going to copy it from here. Paste it here, Just put in the columns. And then the WLAN 0 mod. So the command is very simple. We write airplay ng, then ARP replay, then dash B is the MAC address of our target. In the fake authentication method, we use dash A, but here we need to use dash A dash B actually, then dash H, and then WLAN 0 mon, the interface on which monitor mode is running. So you can see that the data packets are only 36 here, and no data is flowing into the network. But how we can do it? We can just press enter, and now I have a wrong spelling here. So ARP replay, I press enter, and now it is waiting for an ARP packet. So once it gets an ARP packet, it is going to start running it. It is going to start injecting packets into the network, and you can see that it has now started to actually insert packets, and the amount of packets has started to increase. So we need to wait for it and let it run. And on the same time, what we can do is we can actually run aircrack ng. I'm going to split the screen here, and I can say aircrack ng. Then I am going to specify the file I am actually capturing here. So I press enter. Let me make it more clear for you. So here we are actually capturing the packets, and here we are actually capturing the packets, the packets with the new IVs. Here we are running the ARP replay attack, where we are inserting the packets into the traffic again and again, and you can see that it is increasing now. Even no network is connected to the no device is connected to the network, but still the amount of data is increasing now with this attack. And then here we are going to run aircrack ng in the last video, so we can crack the key. So I press enter, and it has started to actually crack the key for us. So we just need to wait. So the data keeps going up, and we keep capturing the packets. And once we have a sufficient number of IVs, we are going to get the key. So let's just wait. Now you can see that we have successfully cracked the key, and we use AirPlay ng, and we used ARP replay attack, and I'm going to actually stop it now that we have cracked the key. And you can see that it was sending 499 packets per second, and these are the number of 91902 ARP requests it sent, and these are the X. You don't need to go into details what X is. It is like a flag on the packet. So, and this is the amount of data it had to capture to crack the key. So sometimes it happens fast, just like when we did it the last time in the basic case. We had to capture a lot of data, but here you can see that we only did it with the 24,000 data packets. And we cracked the key. So if we put this key into the, and it is the same key actually, I did not change it. It is the same key we got from our last attack. So we successfully managed to crack the key. So now that we are done with cracking web encryption, and now we can actually move to the most renowned and most used type of encryption, and which is WPA and WPA2. So WPA and WPA2 are actually the same. The only difference in between them is that the encryption used in WPA2 is actually CCMP, and WPA has a different encryption. But both actually works the same, and the attacks we are going to launch on any of them will work for both of them. So As we saw that in WEP, there was a shorter IV vulnerability, and the random number it was assigning to each packet was very small, and it has to be large because we were able to capture a lot of packets, and then we used aircrack NG to crack the key. So this was the main issue in WEP. And WPA actually came after that to provide better security and better encryption to the network and Wi-Fi's. So in WPA, each packet is encrypted with a unique temporary key. So each of the packet flowing in the network will have a new key. And even if we packet, if even if we capture a lot of packets, just like we did in WEP, it will be regardless, and it will be irrelevant because we don't need to capture packets actually, because they are totally useless, because they won't be helping us to actually decrypt anything, or we cannot extract the key from capturing the packets only. And as I told you, the WPA and WPA2 are similar, and the only difference is the algorithm which is used in them. So to crack WPA or WPA2, we are actually going to exploit a vulnerability in a feature which comes with WPA and WPA2 routers. And that feature is called WPS. So WPS is a feature which allows users to connect to WPS enabled networks easily just using a WPS button. So for example, I have a printer and I want it to connect with the network, or I want to connect it with the router. So what I am going to do is, you can see that there is a button of WPS on the printer actually. So I will just press that button on the printer, and after that I can press the WPS button on the router. So if you look at the back side of your router, you will find a WPS button there, and you can just press the button and your device will be connected to the printer. So the authentication which is done in this process is uses a 8-digit key actually. So that is an 8-digit long pin, and it is a small pin, and we can actually brute force it. And by brute forcing, we can actually capture that key, that 8-digit pin, and we can then take out the password from it. So how this is going to work is, we are going to crack the 8-digit pin actually, and then by that 8-digit pin we are going to extract the password. So I want to tell you that what brute force is. So brute force is a kind of attack in which we try all the possibilities. For example, I say that I have a password which is 4 digits long, so and it contains A, B and C. So I am going to put in all the possibilities which can be made using A, B and C in a 4 digit long pin or long digit number. So brute forcing is actually trying all the possibilities which we can insert or which we can input. So to brute force the pin, we are going to use a tool which is called Reaver, and Reaver is a tool, and we will be looking into it in the next video. But one thing I want you to be very clear about, that WPS is actually a feature of WPA and WPA2, and we are exploiting that flaw, we are exploiting that vulnerability actually. We are not actually in decrypting or trying to crack WPA or WPA2. And we are going to exploit that feature, and by exploiting that feature, we can get an 8-digit key, and then we can use that 8-digit key to actually get the password or extract the password. So we are going to exploit that WPS vulnerability in the next video. So in the last video, we talked that we can actually crack WPA or WPA2 by exploiting a feature which comes with the routers, which can use WPA and WPA2, and that feature is called WPS, and it actually allows devices to connect with the router with just click of a button. So, and it uses a eight digit key, and we can then brute force the key, and we can then crack the WPA password using that pin we have brute forced. And to brute force this pin, we are going to use a software or use a tool which is called Reaver, and Reaver is very easy to use. And we are also going to use another tool which is called Wash, and the interface is very easy. We just write Wash, and then we specify the interface monitor mode is actually running on. So what Wash is going to do is it is going to tell us all the networks which have WPS enabled. So if our attack is going to work only on those router who have WPS enabled on them. So if WPS is not enabled on them or WPS lock is on, so we cannot actually exploit this vulnerability or this flaw. But if WPS is enabled, which is enabled in most of the routers, so we can easily crack the key. We can easily brute force the WPS pin, and then we can crack the key using WPS pin we have brute forced. And for brute forcing WPS pin, we are going to use the Reaver, and the interface for Reaver is very easy. We just write Reaver, then we specify the interface on which monitor mode is running, then we give the target MAC address actually, then the channel it is running on, and VV is just for the verbosity. So it is going to tell us what it is doing actually. So let's get into Kali and see how it is done. So first of all, let me see if I am in monitor mode or not. So you can see I am in monitor mode, and now I can write wash, then I dash I, then WLAN 0 mon. I press enter, and you can see that here are the networks which have WPS enabled actually. So we can try to hack or brute force the WPS pins of all those routers. So you can see that there is a network which is called Virus, then Wireless, then Rogue AP, and then TP-Link. And here you can see the channel they are running on. DBM is the distance from us, and WPS, here it tells the WPS variant it is running. So it is running, Virus is running WPS2, and the lock is off. It means that we can try to brute force the WPS key. So Rogue AP is going to be our target, and now we are going to run Reaver against it, and I'm going to tell you how it works. So we say Reaver, then we can say dash I WLAN 0 mon, and then dash B, and we copy the MAC address from here, we paste it here, then we write dash C, and the channel for Rogue AP is 4, then we say dash VV. So this is very easy. Reaver, we write the name of the tool, then we specify the interface monitor mode is running, which is WLAN 0 mon, then B is the MAC address of our target, then the channel on which Reaver is running actually, the Wi-Fi is running actually, and VV is for the verbosity. You can delete it too. It is not necessary to write VV, but I write it, so it tells us what it is doing actually. So with verbosity, it means that what Reaver is doing in the background, and it keeps telling us which key it is actually trying to brute force actually. So I press enter, and now you can see that the attack has started to run. So I am going, this attack actually takes a lot of time, and I am going to discuss a few things right now. But first of all, I want you to know that you can see that it is trying a pin which is called, the pin is 1234 5670, and then it is sending a packet, and then it is waiting for the response, and then you can see in the next phase it is trying pin 405678. So this is the pin it is trying. First it tried this pin and it failed. After that it tried this pin and it failed too. So it is going to and there are almost 11,000 combinations it can do, and it will try each and every combination with those 8 digits, and then after that it will be going to tell us that it found the pin, and then it will show us the password. So this attack actually takes almost 10 hours to complete, and I cannot do that on the video, but if the attack keeps running, and it will actually find the pin for us. So another thing I want you to tell is that if you are running an attack and then you have to go somewhere, or if you if it is not running properly for you, the reaver has a default option that it saves the session for us. So for example, I run the reaver again and it is asking me that it restore previous session. So I press Y and it starts from the same pin we left it earlier. So our progress is not lost, and we can keep running the attack, and we can go somewhere, then we can come back and start it from here, from there again. So I am letting the attack run for now to let you guys see what it is doing, and you can see that it is telling us that it is trying 5 seconds per pin, and it is taking 5 seconds per pin actually, and this is the progress 0.06%, and this is the key tried 5555567 8, and then in the next phase it tried 6666 5670. So this will keep running, but I cannot do that in the video, as I told you. So for now I'm going to stop it, and then I am actually going to show you the help section of Reaver. So sometimes it happens that you are trying to brute force the pin, and a router actually knows that someone is trying to brute force the pin. So what router is going to do, that it is going to lock the WPSP feature for some time. So once the WPS feature is locked, so we cannot actually keep running our attack. The reason for that is that we are exploiting WPS, and once WPS lock is on, so we cannot actually hack it. You can see that WPS lock is it is saying that no, it means that we can keep brute forcing it. But in some routers you will see that if we keep running the attack for a longer period of time, so this no is going to turn into yes, and our attack will stop. So for that, Reaver has some advanced options here. You can see that you can specify the delay option, that how much time it has to wait to send the next packet. So for example, we can say put 10 seconds here. So once we put 10 seconds here, the reaver is actually going to wait, send a packet, and then it will wait for 10 seconds, and then it will again send the next packet. So using it is very easy. You can just run the same command, and you can specify dash T, and then you can put 10. And you press enter, and it will start running for you, and you can see it is waiting for 10 seconds, and then it will send a packet, and then it will wait for 10 seconds again, and it will send the next packet. So here it is. Now another thing, now that I cannot actually do that on the video, so I am going to use an advanced option from here, which is double dash pin. So I have my double dash pin open here, it is here, and I will copy it from here, and I will specify the option, which is double dash pin, and after that I am going to write the WPS pin for me. So I press enter, and you can see that it is saying that this was a WPS pin and this was actually the password. So the password for rogue AP was metasploit, and it found the password for us just by cracking the WPS pin. So I actually put pin manually here just so I can show you guys in the video that how it is going to work, but you can actually keep running the attack, and in the end it will show the same results for you, where it will find a WPS pin for you first, and then it will tell you the WPA PSK pin, which it is the password actually, which is metasploit. So in the next video I am going to tell you how we can do it using another tool which is called WiFight, and we are going to discuss WiFight in the next video. So now in this video I am going to actually tell you how we can use another tool which is called WiFight. It is a very easy tool, and we don't even need to turn our monitor mode for using this tool. Because the reason is that Wi-Fi does all that for us, and it has many attacks it can run. It has Wi-Fi, WPS Pixie Dust attack, and some other attacks we can do using it. But for now, I am just going to tell you how we can do the attack which we did in the last video, like the WPS brute forcing attack, how we can do it using WiFight. And if you are using a web encryption, the WiFight can also do that for you. So it uses AirCrackNG for web, and it uses the same tool we use. It uses Reaver for brute forcing the WPS key. So for now I am going to show you that we are in manage mode, and we did not turn our monitor mode on, and Wi-Fi is very easy that it does all these things for us automatically. So here you can see that we write Wi-Fi and it says that enabling monitor mode on WLAN 0. And here it says that enable WLAN 0 mon. So we did not have to actually write it manually to turn the monitor mode on. We just write Wi-Fi. This is the name of the tool. You can go to the applications, and here you can see in the wireless attacks you will find Wi-Fi. Here it is. So it is here. So we just write Wi-Fi and it starts for us, and now what it is doing, it is scanning all the networks around us, and it is telling us that we just need to put a number which we want to hack actually. So here is the rogue AP, here is the test network, some other networks it finds, and it is still scanning, and it says that it found 9 targets. And here it says control plus C when ready. So we are ready, and we press control C, and now it is asking us to select the target. So it is saying the select target and which target we actually want to hack. So it is very easy. It is a tool for people who don't even know how to how all those attacks are working, how the packets are flowing, or what vulnerabilities we are exploiting. So this tool is for someone who have no knowledge about hacking. So they can use it to hack Wi-Fi. So I just wanted to show you that we can do it automatically too, and we did it manually, and doing the manual is very better. The reason for that is because you need to know the theory. You need to know that how we are actually running our attacks and what is happening in the background. So you are not a script kiddie. You are actually know what you are doing. So we select rogue AP from here, and here is the number. So we just need to put the number. So we say 1, and if we want to select multiple targets, we can just say comma, and we can say 2 and 3 or 4. But for now, I just want to hack this Wi-Fi. This is rogue AP and the number is 1. So I press 1 and I press enter. So here you can see that it has started to running attacks, and it says starting attacks again against this MAC address, which is rogue AP. And here You can see that it tried this attack WPSPixy does, but it failed because reverse says WPSP not found. And now what it is doing is it has started the WPSpin attack, the same attack we did in the last videos, which was WPS brute forcing attack. So here it is saying WPSpin attack, and that pin attack is running for us manually. And here you can see that in 36 seconds it has tried 7 pins, and this is the progress 0.26%, and here is the type of message it is sending, like sending M4 and M5, then sending ID, and it is telling us that what it is doing in the background. And you can see that it has tried 11 pins and 0.31%. So if you don't want to do it using Reaver, you can actually do it using Wi-Fi, and it is going to show us the number of pins it has actually tried. So when this number reaches to 11,000, you will surely find the key, and you will find the key for you, and you will also get the password against that pin. So if you control C it here, it is asking us that there are two attacks remaining if we want to continue attacking. So we say why, and now it has started another attack, which is called WPA handshake capture. And we're going to talk about what WPA handshake is and how it works, and we're going to discuss it in details in the next coming videos. So and if we don't want to run this attack, we can control C it, and it says that it has stopped working, and now it is not running any attacks, and Wi-Fi has closed. So and it is also telling us that to disable monitor mode when finished using this command. So it is very helpful, it is very easy. It is showing us each and everything on the screen, and it is also giving us instructions what we need to do. So we just need to plug in our card and just start the Wi-Fi, and it will start doing things for us. So if you want to go into some advanced things, you can just try it Wi-Fi help, and it shows us some settings for it. For example, if we want to only hack web, we say Wi-Fi, and then we specify this flag or this option. If we are trying to hack WPA or WPA2, we can just say WPA. And if we want to run the WPS enabled network attacks, and if we want to actually run attacks which are done on WPS, so we can specify this option, and it will leave all other attacks, and it will just do the attack we actually told Wi-Fi to do. So this video, and see you guys in the next video. So when we were breaking the web encryption, what we did was we tried to capture as many packets as we can, so we can then we can actually capture two packets which packet contains same IVs, and then we ran an attack against those IVs using AirCrackNG. The reason for that is because in web encryption, the packets contain a key, and we could actually break that key. But in the WPA encryption, the WPA packets actually do not contain any information which we can use to crack the key and then get the password. But the only packets in WPA or WPA2 encryption which contain some information are the handshake packets. So handshake packets are the packets which we can use to crack the key or get the password. And what handshake packets are, that once you try to connect to a network, or when you try to connect to a Wi-Fi or an AP, a handshake occurs actually. So a handshake is a combination of four different packets. When you try to connect to it, so you will send a request to the AP that I want to connect, and it will send a response back and ask you to send the password. If you have it, then it will process it for you in the third packet, and in the fourth packet it will authenticate you, and it will tell you that yes, you have the right password, and you you can now connect with me. So even if you are trying to connect to the API and you are not actually giving it the right key, but still the handshake actually occurs. It won't be a four-way handshake, but it will still be occurring, and the handshake packets will be flowing between the device and between the router. So we can actually capture those handshake packets, and then we can run a word list attack against those packets to crack the key. So what is a word list? Word list is a file which contains a lot of passwords. It can contain thousands or even millions of millions of words, actually millions of passwords, and then we run that word list against the handshake packets we actually captured. So what this attack is going to do is, the word list attack is going to check each key against that handshake packet we captured, and if it finds the key, so it will tell us that yes, I this is the right password or right key for WPA. But two things we need to capture the handshake and running this word list attack. First we need to capture a handshake packet, and the second thing is a word list, and we are going to run our word list attack against that handshake packet, and we will use that word list. And if WPS is disabled on that network, like and our attack which we tried in the last video failed for us, so we can use this method to crack WPA, and we can find the key or password using this method. And if our word list contains the password of the Wi-Fi, this method is going to work 100%, and there are no chances that you would fail. So in the next video, I'm going to actually tell you how we can create a word list of our own choice, and what parameters we can set, and what things we need to do to capture to actually make a word list, and then we are going to use that word list against the handshake, and by doing that we can actually get the key. As we discussed in the last video, that in order to break WPA or WPA2, we need to capture the handshake packet, and we will be needing a word list. So in order to run the word list attack against a handshake packet, we actually need a handshake packet first. So in this video, I'm going to tell you how we can actually capture a handshake. So we are going to use the same method we used in the last videos, where we were trying to break the web key and capture the packet. So we're going to use AeroDump NG to capture those packets, and you are pretty similar with the format and with the command how we can do that. If you do not know, you can go to the older lessons and you will find the detailed videos for it, that how we can actually capture packets. So once we start capturing the packets, now we need to wait for a handshake packet. So there are two ways of capturing the handshake packet. So as I told you, that a handshake packet is sent into the network once a client or a new device tries to connect to the API or to the router. So we have two options here. First option is that we can actually sit back and wait for a client to connect to the API. Or the other method is that we can actually deauthenticate a client which is already connected to the network, and then we can and then it will try to reauthenticate itself, and then we can capture the handshake in that process. So to deauthenticate a device, we can use AirPlay NG, and I have told you how we can do that in the last video too. So if you don't know how it is done, you can go to the previous videos and you will find a detailed video for it too. So once our handshake is captured, the top right corner of AeroDump NG will say WPA handshake. So let's get into Kali and see how we actually do it. So let me see if I am in monitor mode. So yes, I am in monitor mode, and I am going to run AeroDump NG for all the networks.
So here is my test network. I'm going to test it here. So I can say aerodump ng, then I write BSS ID, and the BSS ID is, sorry, I am actually going to use this network, Rogue AP. So I will copy its MAC address, paste it here, then I can say channel, and the channel is 4. Then I can say WLAN 0 mon, and here I need to actually write the file I want to capture the handshake in. So the command is simple. We just write aerodump ng, then BSS ID of the target network, then the channel it is running on, then this is the file where we actually want to store our output in. So we press enter and it will start capturing the packets for us. So right now you can see that this section is empty. So in here now we can actually wait for a new client to connect to the network, or the other thing we can do is we can actually deauthenticate any of these two devices, and we can actually deauthenticate any of these two devices, and once they try to connect again, we are going to capture our handshake. So here I am actually going to type in the command to deauthenticate a network, a device from the network. So I write deauthenticate, then I put the target MAC address, which is this, and then I will put the MAC address of the device I actually want to disconnect. So I copy this is not copying for me. I can actually write it. So one c 56 fe c3 e4 and then 04, and then I just put in the network adapter. So here it is now deauthenticating the device for us, and we're going to see that we have actually captured the WPA handshake. I will let it run, and then in some time when the device tries to reconnect, and we will see that there is an option, there is a line available here which will be saying that WPA handshake is captured. So now you can see that we have successfully managed to actually capture the handshake, and it is saying that it captured WPA handshake for this device, and you can see that this is the MAC address of our target device which we are connecting. So we have successfully managed to capture the handshake. So now that we have captured the handshake, we just need a word list to run the word list attack against this handshake we captured. So in the next video, I'm going to tell you how we can create a word list, and then and in the next videos, we're going to actually try to crack the key for WPA or WPA2. Now that we have captured the handshake, and now what we need is we need a word list. So what is a word list? So word list is actually a file. You can think of it as a text file which contains a lot of passwords. There are many passwords in it. And then what aircrackng is going to do, aircrackng is going to run all those words against the handshake we have captured. So if the word list contains the WPA password or WPA key or the Wi-Fi key, in the word list, so aircrackng is going to tell us that this is the key or this is the password for that Wi-Fi or for that AP. So there are two ways we can get a word list. That there are word lists available on internet, and we can download it. Here is the link I have given, and you can find You can find some word list from internet from there. And the other way is you can use a program which is called Crunch, and Crunch is used to make customized word lists actually. So the format for using Crunch is very easy. We just type in Crunch, which is the name of the tool. Then we tell it the number of minimum digits we want it and the maximum digit for the password. And then we specify any special characters we want. We can say at the rate or percentage sign or dollar sign or any other signs we want to use. And if we want to use uppercase letters or lowercase letters, we can specify it after telling it the maximum number of digits. And then the pattern is very important here, because for example, we saw someone writing a password, and now we know that the first digit is A, or the first digit is 2 or 3. So we can write it like this. Like, we can say that the password starts from A, and then there are actually 4 digits in between it, and then at the end we saw that the person wrote the letter B, or any letter you saw him writing. So we can specify the pattern, and all the passwords in the word list will be starting with an A and ending with a B. So in the example, you can see that there is Crunch, and then the number of passwords, the length of the password will be at least 6 digits, then it will be 8 digits, and then we specify some characters we want the password list to include. Then the output file, this is the dash O, and this is the name of the output file, and then the pattern. So we don't need to actually specify the pattern in every word list. It can be, for example, if we don't know what is the starting number or what is the starting digit, so we can just specify the characters we want to include in the password, and then the minimum and the maximum length. So let's get into Kali and see how it is done actually. So we go to Kali. I will put my password. So the tool is very simple. We can actually write Crunch and then help. So it tells us the usage, and if you want to see some extra options for it, so we can enter manual. We can write manual, M-A-N, then the name of the tool, so manual Crunch, and it is going to show us some advanced option we can use with it. So I want you to look into it by yourself, because I cannot explain all of these things in the video, but some basic things I have told you about. So for example, we want to create a password which has 5 digits maximum and minimum, sorry, and then the 7. So the password we are going to create will be minimum of the 5 digits, and then maximum of 7 digits, and we want to include, for example, these five digits in the word list. Then we specify the output, and we can say it word list, and just press enter. So now it is telling us that Crunch will generate the following amount of data, and there will be almost 96,875 passwords contained in this word list which we have created actually. So now let's read it. We can write cat word list, and now you can see that our file is created, and it has all the possible combinations which can be made using the options we have specified. So I'm going to clear it, and now let's have a look at a kind of word list which is a pattern word list. So for example, I say Crunch, and then I say I want the least number of the password will be 6, and then I can say that the maximum number is 6 too, and then I can again specify A, B, C, D, and 1, and then the pattern is dash t, and for example I want my all my passwords to start with the letter b, so I can say b, then I am going to specify, and I want my password to actually end at a, for example, so I put in a. So I am telling that each password should be starting with b and it should be ending with an a, and in the end I can say the output will be patterned word list and I press enter, and now Crunch will generate the following number of lines, and it has only created 625 outputs actually. For the reason is because we told it that every password should start with B and end with an A. So now we can actually look at this and we can say pattern word list, and here we can see that all the passwords or all the words are starting with a B and ending with an A, and all the passwords are only 6 length. So the reason is because we told it that that is how we want to create the word list, and we can specify any characters we want to. For example, I'm going to clear this so we can write Crunch, and then I want, for example, if you want to create a big word list, so you can say 8 and 15, and then you can specify A, B, D, A, B, A, or F, then and at hash. So these are all the characters you want the Crunch to include in the passwords, and then you can specify the output file and then any pattern you want to set. So Crunch is very easy to use. And then we are going to use that word list against the handshake packet we actually captured. So if the word list contains the Wi-Fi password, so aircrackng is going to tell us that this is the password, and if the password is not included in the word list, so we need to try another word list, and then we can try another word list, and then if we are creating a word list which is very big and it contains actually all the number of possibilities, so our attack is 100% going to work. The reason is because aircrackng has to check each and every word or password against that handshake. And you can actually go to Google and you can see that there are many word lists available on GitHub actually. So you can download from here, for example. I click it here, and now you can see that there are word lists available, like this contains 1000 words, then there is a Wi-Fi WPA, there is a malware word list, honeypot captures word list. So there are many type of word lists available here, and you can use them against any handshake you capture. So in the next video, what we are going to do is we are going to use a word list against the handshake we captured, and then we are going to launch our word list attack using aircrackng, and then see if our word list actually contains the password, and we will be able to break the password or get the Wi-Fi key if our word list contains the password or the key. Our word list too. So what we can do is we can now run aircrackng and try to run the word list attack against the handshake file we have captured, and then we can actually get the key if it is included in the word list. So let me tell you how aircrackng is going to do it. So what aircrackng is going to do, it is going to combine each password in the word list against the pairwise master key, and the algorithm it uses, it is called PBKDF2 algorithm. So the handshake we have captured actually contains some information, and by that information there is a code generated using that information, and that code is called message integrity code. So aircrackng is going to take out that message integrity code And what message integrity code does is that it tells if a password is correct or not. So AirTrackNG is going to compare each MIC against the MIC of that packet we have captured, of the handshake packet. And then if the password is true and it is included in the word list, so AirTrackNG is going to tell that yes, this is the password. And if it is not the correct password, it will move on to the next word and then create a new MIC and then compare it with the MIC of the packet actually. So this is how it actually works in the background. The format for using AirCrackNG is very simple. We just put in the name of the program, AirCrackNG, then the handshake file we want to run the attack against, and then the word list. So let's get into Kali and see. So here is a word list I made, and I actually have it open right now. Let's see. And what I am going to do is I am going to add my password in this word list. So I am going to add my password here, which is meta-supplied, because I don't have my password in this word list, so I am including it manually. Because I cannot actually create word lists in which my password is included, so I am including it only manually, so I can tell you how this attack will work and how actually this is AirCrackNG is going to crack the key. So I'm going to let it save actually, because it is a very large list and it almost contains millions of password in it, and it is going to take some time to save. Then once it's saved, we can actually run the word list attack against the handshake we have captured and then the word list. So let it save for me. So now our word list is saved, and you can see that I have my password included here, and now we can run the attack. So let's get into Kali. Let's get into terminal, and I can say clear. So how we are going to do is, let's ls, and you can say that this is our handshake packet and this is our word list we are going to run the attack against. So we are going to use a tool which we used before, which is called AirCrackNG, and with that we are going to specify the handshake packet name, which is handshake packet 01.cap, and then we specify the word list option, that is dash w, and the word list is word list, so we can say word list. So this is very easy. We just write down the tool, which is AirCrackNG, and then we type in handshake packet name, which is handshake packet 01, then the word list, and that's all. And what we have to do is we just need to press enter. So here you can see that it actually found the password and did very quickly for me. If I run it again, and so it is finding very quickly for me, but you can see that it is telling us that these are the number of keys, total number of keys in the word list, and it checked 12 keys, and it didn't even took it a second actually. It did it very fast for me. And it is telling us that it actually checked 28.72 keys per second. That was the speed, and this was the time left if it actually went through all the words in the word list. So this is the amount of time it would have taken. This actually shows us the progress, and this is the key actually. So this is the key for our Wi-Fi network which we were trying to hack, which was Rogue AP. And these were all the hashes it was making, and it was comparing them, and by using that attack, that is word list attack, we actually found the key, and the key is meta-supplied. So one thing I want you guys to be very clear about is that if our word list does not contain the Wi-Fi password or Wi-Fi key, so we are not going to get this output. So if the word list actually contain the Wi-Fi password, AirCrackNG is going to guess it for us, and if the word list does not contain the password, so there is no way that AirCrackNG can tell us the password. The only way is that it is going to match the output of the handshake packet, which is MIC, with the MIC it actually gets from putting the words in the word list, And once it finds the real key for it, it is going to tell us. Just like here, because this password was actually included by me in the word list, so that is why CrackNG actually managed to get the key for it. So that will be all for this video, and see you guys in the next video. Now that we know that how a hacker can actually hack our Wi-Fi, or he can actually get into the network, we can look into some security measures we can do to save us. So first thing I am going to talk about is the deauthentication attack, in which a hacker actually tried to manage to disconnect us from the network. So in order to save ourselves from the deauthentication attack, the only measure we can do is we can use a wired cable, actually, because this is the only way to save ourselves from the attack, actually. So there are some settings I want to show you for the router, actually, for the wireless network you can set. But first of all, I'm going to tell you how we can actually access the router settings or the page. So I'm going to write ifconfig is for the Linux machines. For Windows we have ipconfig, and here we can see that this is my IP. So 192.168.1.103, and let me actually close it, and here it is. So we can see that 192.168.1.103 is our IP, and the router is actually on the first IP of the subnet. So if I want to open the settings of my router, it will be 192.168.1.1 only. So I type in 192 and it is open for me. Now for you, it is going to ask you for a password. So the default password is actually written on the back side of the router, or it is on the manual, so you can look into it and see that what is the default password for you, default username and password for you. And I recommend you to actually change it for the first time you log in, and you can change it because it is very easy for someone who is connected to your network to use the default password and then get into it, because the default password for every router is available on the internet, and if someone actually entered your network, they can save the changes and they can do anything they want to do with you. So first thing I'm going to tell you about is WPS. So it is showing up QSS for me, but it is actually WPS. It is the same thing. Don't confuse yourself. It is written QSS. It is WPS. And the first thing you need to do is you can disable WPS for you. So the reason for that is that if you disable WPS, so nobody can use Weaver to actually run the brute force attack, and they won't be able to reverse engineer the key, reverse engineer the password for Wi-Fi. And the attack in which we actually brute forced the WPS key, it won't run for us if WPS is actually disabled for us. The other settings I want you to look into is the wireless settings, and you can see that I can specify the channel here. And another thing I want to talk about is the enable SSID broadcast feature. So if you disable it, I mean if you don't want to enable SSID, so SSID is the Wi-Fi name we see when we try to connect to a Wi-Fi. So for example, if this is disabled and someone tries to look at what Wi-Fis are available for us, or what networks are available for us, so he won't be seeing the name of our IP. So this dialogue or this option for us to connect with the network won't be available for us because the SSID broadcast is disabled. So this is a security measure you can use, but it is not very effective because we saw that in Kali we actually managed to see all the networks which were hidden too, and the reason for that is because our device was actually checking was capturing the beacons which were emitted by the router, So this is a security measure you can use, but it is not very effective. And in wireless security, I highly recommend you don't disable the security. Do not use WEP, because WEP is an old encryption and it can be easily breakable just by capturing packets and then using AirCrackNG to capture IVs and then break the key. So we saw that how we can hack WEP in just 15 to 20 minutes, and it is very easy to break. So don't use WEP. It is not recommended by me or any other security personnel. So and use WPA and WPA2. It is an international standard and it is used everywhere. So and another thing, that my password is very simple. It is Metasploit. It is very simple. But if someone wants to run a wordless attack against me, just like we did in the last video, and if they want to, if they have my password written in the wordless and they have my password available in the wordless, they can easily hack me. So what I would recommend you to is to use some numbers or to use some special characters in your password. Keep your passwords long, up to 14 digits or even 16 to 17 digits, but 14 digits is the standard which is used internationally, and you can use that. So wireless MAC filtering. So this is a very important feature. So for example, if you have only three users at your home, and you know that, and you don't want anyone else to connect with your Wi-Fi, so even if they get the key, they won't be able to use your Wi-Fi if you add the MAC addresses here. So for example, you have three devices, you can just simply put the MAC addresses of those devices here one by one, and only those three devices will be allowed to connect to your router. So if a hacker even gets to hack your Wi-Fi and they try to connect with your network, they will be able to connect with your network, but they won't be able to access the internet. So this technique of the wireless MAC filtering is very useful for a company, actually, because a company has some number of employees, and company do not allow its employees to actually connect with the network using their mobile phones or their personal PCs. So they use MAC filtering. So they put the MAC addresses of their own PCs, and then only those PCs are allowed to connect to the network. So these were some settings I wanted you to look into, and you can actually set them for you, and then you can actually save yourself from some of the attacks we discussed. Hello guys, and welcome to the post connection attack section. So all the attacks we did before were without knowing the password to the network, and we were not actually the part of the network, and we did not know the password for the Wi-Fi or the AP, and we were not connected to any network. So we were actually doing all those attacks by staying out of the network, and we did deauthentication attacks, and we actually sniffed the packets, and we tried to crack WAP, WPA and WPA2 using several attacks, and we looked how to actually fake authenticate ourselves, and how we can run wordless attacks to find the password for a WPA or WPA2 networks. So we did all those attacks by being in the monitor mode, and we were not actually part of the network. So all the attacks we are going to do in this section will be after we connect to a network, actually. So for example, you are not connected to a network, then you turn your wireless adapter to the monitor mode, and then you hack into a Wi-Fi, and now you know the password, and now you put in the password, and you are part of the network now. So the post connection attacks are the attacks we can do after we are connected to a network, and then we can run all the attacks I am going to teach you in this section after connecting to the network. So one thing I want you to be very clear about, that the mode for this section will be the manage mode, which is the default mode. The reason for that is because in all the previous attacks, we actually wanted to capture all the packets which are running around us. But for now, in this section, we are part of the network and we only want to capture packets which are actually only directed to us. So the monitor mode will not be in the so the mode will not be in the monitor mode. It will be in manage mode, because in monitor mode we cannot connect to any network and we cannot access the internet. And another thing is that if you don't have many wireless adapter cards and you don't want to actually test all those attacks by connecting wireless attacks to different virtual machines, I am going to actually want you to make sure that you are on the same network, then we can use Ethernet 0 for all the machines. So here you can see in settings that my network is here NAT network, and I am connected to NAT network, and it is similar for Windows machine, and we are going to actually try to hack this machine by doing some attacks. So in the network here you can see that I am on the same NAT network that I am on the Kali network. So when we start these two machines, it means that both of these machines will be on the same network, and they will have the same subnet. For example, if the IP address of Kali is 192.168.8.1, then the IP for Windows 10 can be 192.168.8.1.2 or 3 or 100 or any number from up to 255, but not 1. So both of them will be on the same network, and then we can run all those attacks we are going to learn in this section on the machines which are connected to us, connected to the same network actually. So in the previous videos, when we were using AeroDump to actually capture the packets, we remember that we were able to discover all the APs around us, and also the clients which are connected to those APs. And the MAC addresses for those of those devices which are connected to those Wi-Fi networks or the APs. So now that we are on a network, we can actually gather more information about the clients or devices which are connected to the same network on which we are connected actually. So we can now use many different programs or softwares or tools to determine some more information about the devices which are connected to our network. So in the gathering information phase, we are going to use three different programs, and we will try to gain as much information we can gain about those devices, so we can have the information that what operating system they are running, or what vulnerabilities they have, or what ports they have opened. Or for example, if we are running those programs or tools on a router, so we can know that what manufacturer or vendor the router is, and some more stuff about that. So the first program we are going to use is NetDiscover. So NetDiscover is a very simple tool, and it only gives us some little information about the clients, like it can tell us about their IPs, that which IPs those devices are using. It can tell us the MAC addresses of those devices, and sometimes it also gives us the vendors or manufacturers of those devices. So, and it also tells us that how far those devices are from the router. So the method of using it is very simple. You can see this, we just write the NetDiscover, the name of the tool, then the interface. This is the interface of our wireless adapter, and then the range. We specify the range, that what range we actually want it to scan. So here is the example, and it will get more clear when we do it on the Kali machine. So let's get into Kali and see how it is done. So now I am going to show you actually that my wireless adapter is actually in managed mode, and we are not running it on monitor mode because we don't need monitor mode anymore. And now I am going to connect to a network actually. So let's go to Wi-Fi settings, and here is the rogue AP. And in the last section, we saw that how we can actually succeeded to gain its password. Actually, I am going to put the password here, which is meta supply it, and then I will connect with it. So if config it here, and I can see that my WLAN 0 is on 192.168.1.104. So this is the IP address of my machine, which is assigned to my Kali machine. So I'm going to actually clear it, and now we will look into NetDiscover. So the tool is very simple. We just type in NetDiscover, then we give it the interface, which is WLAN 0, which is running on managed mode, and then the range. So the range is 192.168.1.1/24. So I'm going to explain what this is. So in a network range, there are actually 255 devices can be connected, and it starts from 192.168.1.0, then it goes to 1.1, then 1.2, then 1.3, then it keeps going up to 254 actually. So I am actually telling it here that I want to scan the whole network range, all the network range from 192.168.1.0 to 192.168.1.254. So this is what I am telling it to do. So that is how we write it if we want to scan the whole network range. And I'm now going to press enter. So it starts to actually scan the network for me. So here we can see that we have the results here. And it tells us that it got 3 hosts from it, and there is one device, and it has this MAC address. This is my router actually, and my router is on 192.168.1.1. This is my router, and it is a TP-Link router. And then it is telling me that there is another device which is connected to it, which has an IP of 192.168.1.100. This is the MAC address, and this is a Motorola device. This is actually my mobile phone. So it is telling me that Motorola Mobility LLC, this is the name of the company. Then there is another device, which is 103. This is the MAC address, and it is also telling me the vendor. So NetDiscover is a very simple tool, and it actually discovers some little information, and we can, this IP address is actually a very useful information. We can then further scan this IP address using some other tool like Nmap or any other, or Zenmap. We can put the IP, and then we can gain more information about these devices, and then see how we can actually try to hack into them. So we are going to look into two more tools after this, and you will be surprised about all those attacks we can do once we are on the network. And you can see that I am on this network, and now I'm going to run attacks on the devices which are connected to this network. So now that we have gained some information using NetDiscover, and we were able to discover the IP addresses and also the MAC addresses for the for those devices which are connected to our network, and also their vendors too. NetDiscover actually gives us only some little information, and it was not very helpful for us. So now we are going to look into another tool, which is called Nmap. So Nmap actually gives us very, very detailed information about our target and the clients which are connected to our network. And Nmap can also be used for scanning web applications and networks too. So Nmap is a terminal based network scanner, and it is a very also a vulnerability scanner actually, because it comes with a lot of pre-written and pre and do with Nmap actually. And we are not limited to IP addresses or the manufacturers or the MAC addresses only. So Nmap is actually a very, very big tool, and it contains a lot of information and a lot of options you can set for it. So I cannot actually teach you all of that in a single lecture, but I will walk you through all the options you can set with Nmap, and I also will be telling you some basic usage, that how you can use Nmap. And after Nmap, we are going to look into Zenmap. So Zenmap is actually a graphical user interface of Nmap, and it works the same as nmap works, but the only difference is that in nmap you have to be on the terminal and you have to specify your options by yourself, but zenmap has some pre-built or kind of default scans which you can run just by one click. You just have to specify the IP address and then you can actually get your results. So first of all, we're going to look into nmap, and then after that we will move forward to zenmap and see what we can do with zenmap. So let's get into nmap. So here is our terminal, and first of all I want to show you that I am connected to a network. We do it using ifconfig, and you can see that I am connected to a network with WLAN 0 and this is my IP address. So let's see some options for nmap. We just type in nmap help, and now we can see all the options and flags we can set when we use nmap actually. So these are some basic settings. For example, if you only want to do a list scan, that you only want to see the devices or the clients which are connected to our network, so we use dash SL. If we only want to do a ping scan, for example, we don't want nmap to actually scan the ports too. So nmap actually scans the ports by default. So if we don't want nmap to scan the ports, we can only set the dash SN flag and it will not scan the ports for us. And for example, if nmap is trying to scan a network and it could not find any information or it could not find any clients, so what we are going to do is we can use the dash PN option, which is saying that treat all hosts are online. So it will presume that that there are a lot of devices connected, and it will actually try harder to gain the information about them. So here are the scan techniques, and you can see that we can specify dash SS. This is a very important feature of nmap, that we can do TCP SYN connect attack, or it is also called a SYN stealth scan. And what this scan does is it scans all the TCP ports for the network. Here it is a dash SU, and in dash SU option nmap actually scans for the UDP ports. So the ports which use services of UDP, it will going to scan those for us. If you don't know what TCP and UDP is, I want you to go on Google and try to find out that what TCP and UDP is. And another thing I want you to look into is you can look into TCP IP protocol. So those two things are very important to know, that what TCP is and what UDP is, and also try to find some services which use these type of protocols. So this is dash SX is a XMS scan, and we cannot run these type of scans against the Windows. There are only some specific operating system we can run these XMS scans, so we are not going to use them a lot. This is dash SI, it is called idle scan, and in idle scan if we have a zombie host, or if we have a computer already compromised in the network, so we can use it. So you can see that it is saying zombie host. So we have to put two IPs in this type of scan actually. So with the dash P option, you can specify a single port. For example, if you ran a long scan with nmap and you found that there are four or five ports open for a target, so the next thing you can do is you can scan a single port for that device, and then you can go into more details and see what information you can gain with it. Here it is also telling us the the example at how we can use the port flag and what spe options we can specify after that. So fast mode dash f is only the fast mode. It will scan fewer ports, and this is a random scan that it will not scan it like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It will just do a random scan. And here are the service version detection. So this is a very, very great feature of nmap, that it actually tells us the service versions and the versions which are running on a network actually. So for example, we scan port 22. Port 22 is a port which runs a service which is called SSH. So for example, we scan SSH, we know that port 22 is open, and now we know that there is an SSH available for us. So with the dash SV flag, we can actually try to find the version of SSH running on that port actually. And here is the script scan. So I told you that nmap is a vulnerability scanner too, and there are a lot of scripts which nmap comes with. So using this flag, we are actually telling nmap to use those scripts to scan too. And OS detection dash O is, if we specify the dash O flag, it is going to tell us that which operating system our targets are running actually, and we're going to look into it, and it will get more clear. And here is timing and performance. So there are a few ways we can use the dash T flag. For example, if we say dash T and then we specify 5, so the scan is going to be very fast. If we do dash T3 or dash 2, T2, so the scan is going to be slow. And we keep our scans to dash T4. The reason is that if we actually do T5 and it sends a lot of packets at the same time, and in a real-time environment, our IP can actually get blocked. So we want to keep it simple, and we want to keep it slow and random, so we do not get actually detected. And this is that if we specify dash OA, it is going to just store the output for us, the scan we ran, and then we can look at the results after the scan is complete. And this is dash V, which tells us the verbosity. We looked into it before, and I told you that if you want to know that what our tool is actually doing in the background, we can just say dash V, or we can also use dash double V for greater effects. Like we want nmap to actually give us more details about what it is doing. Here it is dash A, and dash A is actually a complete package where it will be enabling OS detection too. It will also be doing variant detection, and it will do script scanning and the trace routing. So for example, we want to know the OS detection too, and we want to do the script scan too, and the service detection too. So we don't have to specify these flags separately. We can just say dash A, dash capital A, and it is going to do all that for us. Here, it is telling us there's some examples that how we can actually use nmap. For example, it is saying nmap, then the verbosity, and then this is the ping scan, and then the IP address. So we can actually specify a whole nmap, a whole range of actually nmap. Of the network actually, and we can scan the whole network, and we can scan all the web applications too with it. So in the next video, we are going to look into some scans we can use with nmap, and then we will move to the ZenMap. So now when I have walked you through some of the basic help section and what flags we can set with nmap, I am actually going to show you how we can do it here on the terminal actually, and how we actually do the scan. So for example, I am going to only run a default scan, a very simple scan on the whole network, and which is 192.168.1.1/24. And I told you that how we actually scan the whole network range. This is actually telling nmap to scan whole network for us, which is the 255 devices or the clients or the IP addresses or the nodes which are connected to the network, and if they are up or if they are not. So here are the results, and you can see that nmap is telling us that this is my router, and it is telling us that nmap scan report, and it is telling us that port 80 is open, and it is a TCP port, and the service it is running, it is HTTP, and this is, there is another port open which is 1900, and the protocol is TCP, and it is open port, and then it is running UPnP. Now it is telling us the MAC address for our device, which is this, and it is also telling us the vendor, which is TP-Link Technologies, and it is right. So there is another scan report for this IP address, and it is telling us that there is a device connected at this IP address, and these are all the ports which are opened for this device. So this is my Windows device, and it is telling us that 5060 TCP port is open, and the service is SIP, and all of these ports are open. So this is my mobile actually, and this is telling us that now that, for example, I confused it with my Windows machine, but now when I came down and nmap told me that the MAC address is this, and this is a Motorola mobility device. So now I know that this is the scan results for my mobile actually. So you can see that how we can gain very, very useful information using nmap. And now it is scanning this device, which is 103, and this is my laptop actually, and it is telling me that these three ports are open. This NetBIOS port is open, Microsoft DS port is open, which is in 445, this is the MAC address. And this is my actually Kali device, and it failed to gain some information about Kali. And I told you that Kali is actually a very secure system when we want to use. It is a very secure operating system. So you can say that, see that nmap was not able to find any information on it. But it actually told us that there is a device connected at 192.168.1.104. So now we can actually run some advanced scans for this device and try to find information about it. And it is not that nmap actually failed. It told us it succeeded to find a device, but it did not go into details. So for now, now that we know that there is a port 80 open at my router, so let's see, let's try to actually scan this port only and try to find the service version of 80 or HTTP it is running on it on my router. So I can say nmap, then 192.168.1.1. So here I am specifying only one IP for it. And then I can say dash P, and here you can see that I am telling nmap to only scan port 80. Now there is one thing I want to tell you, is that for nmap actually scans only first 1000 ports by default. So if I want to scan all the 65535 ports, I can write it like 1265535. I put an extra 5. So 6535 is the number of ports which are available on a network actually, on a server, on a device. So writing this, I am actually telling nmap to scan all the ports which are available on a server or on a network on a single device. And I can also write it as dash p dash, and it is going to give us the same output. So for now, I'm only want to scan port 80, and then I can write dash sv to find the version. And another flag I'm going to set is dash t5. So I told you that With the time option, we can actually control the speed of the scan. So if I put T5, it means that the scan is going to be more faster. And if I specify dash T3, it means that scan is going to be a little slow. And dash T1, it is very very slow and it can take a lot of time. So I am so we actually specify the time options when we are scanning a network and trying to hack into a system, because we don't want to get detected. So nmap is a very noisy tool and it can be detected very easily. To actually give the gap between the packets nmap sent, we can specify the dash T option dash, and then we can say dash T2 or dash T3, and it is going to run the scan very slow and we won't be getting detected. But for now, we are not afraid of getting detected. We are only scanning our own network, so we can say dash T5 and then press enter. And sometimes nmap the scans can take a lot of time to complete, so don't worry about it. You can just wait, or there is another thing you can do. You can just specify dash VV, so you can know that yes, what is happening in the background. So you can see that the output for this was very small, but here we actually see all the detailed things that what nmap actually was doing. So it is telling us that it is initializing an ARP ping scan. Then it told us that it is scanning one port. Then it told us that it completed ARP ping scan. Then stealth scan, and all these things. And in the end, here is our output. So you can see that now we have more detailed information about the port 80. It is telling us that it is port 80. It is running a protocol which is TCP. The state is open. The service is HTTP. And it is telling us the version. So this is actually the version we found, and this is the version it is running. It is a TP-Link WR841N. This is the MAC address, this is TP-Link, and this is the service info. And this is a lot of cool stuff that we found just by putting one flag, which is dash SV, that we actually managed to find the service versions. So now I'm actually going to clear it. So let's see, we want to know what operating systems our devices are running which are connected to our network. So for that, I'm going to specify /.1/.1/24. So I am telling it to scan my whole network. And then what I want to tell it is, I want it to find the operating systems for all the devices which are connected on our network. So I can say dash T5. And another thing, I can just say dash SN, that I don't actually want it to scan the ports, because if we scan the ports too, that will be a very long scan. So I want it dash SN, and what SN is used, SN actually tells nmap that it don't want to scan the ports, it only want to do the ping scan. So let's press enter. So it is telling us that OS scan is unreliable without a port scan. So you can see that nmap is actually helping us that how we can actually arrange our scan. So what options are available with one thing, and what options are not available with the other thing. So we cannot actually detect operating system without scanning the ports, and it is a very obvious thing. I actually did it, so you guys can know that yes, actually we cannot find the operating system just by ping scan. We cannot detect the operating system just by sending ICMP packets. We need to scan the ports, and then nmap will check some fingerprints against those operating system, and it will then find the result for us. So now I remove dash SN, and my scan is running, and it will show the output for us in a minute. So here is our result. and let's see what we found. And here it is. So for the scan report for 1.1, which is our router, it is telling us that the OS version it is running, it is Linux 2.6.15, and this is my mobile device, and it is telling me that it is a Motorola mobility device. And here is a warning. You can read that this is a warning, and it is saying that warning, OS scan results may be unreliable because we could not find at least one open and one closed port. So it is telling us that just don't be very sure about these results. It is trying, it tried to guess, and this is what it found. So it is telling us that my mobile is running Microsoft Windows 2003, which is not correct. So sometimes it can fail, and sometimes and most of the time, after times, it actually tells us the correct correct output. So this is my laptop on which I am actually scanning the video right now. I am actually making the video right now. So you can see that it is telling us that it is just guessing, and it is telling us that it is a Microsoft Windows, which is correct. So Nmap actually tried to find that we are running a Microsoft Windows operating system, but what it failed to find is it could not tell that it is a Windows 10. So it is telling us that it might be a Windows XP or a 7 or 2008, and it is also telling us that how much it thinks that it is correct. So it is telling us that it is 87% correct. So it is a 50-50 result, and it found some information that yes, we are running Microsoft Windows, and then we can enumerate more, we can search more, we can do more advanced scans, and then we can find more information, and the results will be more correct. So we are only doing very limited scans right now. So for example, I want to save my output. So I am going to actually run the old scan again, which we ran here. So I want to actually save my output. So to save the output, I can say dash OA, and then I specify the name. For example, I can say port 8080 scan, and I just press enter. So what this dash OA is going to do is it is going to store my output. So now that my scan is complete, I can cat port 80 not nmap. So this is the file I am opening, and I am telling it to open it in cat, and I press enter, and you can see that here is the result we got. So it is saved for us. I can also open it with gedit. I can say gedit and then port 80 scan not nmap, and it will open it in a editor for us. So here you can see we have the scan results. So we have the scan results saved, and we can actually check it after we have finished scanning, and after we have finished our work, and then we can work on those scans. Another scan I want to actually tell you here very quick. So nmap and so dash sc. So I told you that nmap is a vulnerability scanner too, and it actually scans with some script. So if we put dash sc, so what it is going to do is it is actually going to run all the scripts in the scanning and then show the scan results for us. So this is a long scan too, but we can try. But the output will be very similar, but it can get different when it comes to scanning web applications and other things, because then it is very fruitful. So and I actually stopped it, and you can try it with yourself using dash sc, and you can see you can also actually put a lot of options in it with the help command I told you, and As I said, there is a lot I want to tell you, but I cannot do that on a single video. But there are a lot of things I actually want walked you through. For example, another scan we can look into is dash SL. So in the last scans, we saw that Nmap was scanning the ports for us too. So this is just a list scan, and you can see that it scanned the ports for us. So it is just a list scan. So it only listed all the older devices. So, and if I want to do SN, and you can see that this is a ping scan, and it did not scan any ports for us. It only scanned the devices and saying that yes, this is a device, this is a router, and it is TP-Link. Then there is another device, and it is 192.168.100. It is a Motorola device, and then the next device, and then it keeps going on like that. So we can do small scans, we can do large scans, and we can do a lot of crazy stuff using it. I want you to go into the help menu. I want you to go through each and every option available here. Use these options and then see what difference you get. By the SS, I actually remember that if you want to do a stealth scan, that you want to scan the TCP ports, you can say dash SS. If you want to also to scan UDP ports, you can use dash SU. And these are very important options when we actually scanning web applications or networks. So this is very important. Go look into TCP and UDP and see what services they run. And you can actually also scan, for example, I say nmap google.com, I press enter, and it will show the result for me in a minute. So I am not actually specifying a IP, I am actually specifying it just the domain for the google.com, and it will find the result for me in a second. So it is telling me that the port 80 is open for Google, and port 443 is open for Google, which is HTTP and HTTPS. So we can actually scan websites from with using Nmap. So if you want a verbosity output, you can see that it is pinging, and all that stuff is going on in the background. So you can actually scan the websites with it, and you can see what results you get. Just play with Nmap a little more, and you will be very pleased to use it actually. And in some countries, you can actually scan websites, and it is allowed and it is legal. So if it is legal for you, you can go and then start playing with Nmap. And in the next video, we will talk about Zenmap, which is a graphical user interface, and then we will see that how we can actually scan using Zenmap without we can actually scan with Nmap using Zenmap without being on a terminal. So we are going to learn that in the next video. So now that we know that how we can use Nmap to scan the networks, and how we can scan the targets, or we can actually scan a whole network range with the Nmap, and I told you and I walked you actually through the help section of the Nmap, and I told you how we can actually enable OS detection, how you can find that what operating system our targets are running. I told you about the service versions and how to store the output, and also specify some different flags and different types of scan. So this time we are going to actually look into a tool which is called Zenmap. So Zenmap is actually a graphical user interface for Nmap. It is the same tool. It is a little easier for to use, because it provides us an easy interface where we can actually select the default scans and set the specific options we want, and each and every six sections are divided here. But Zenmap actually uses Nmap in the background for scanning. So as you can see the name, it is saying Zenmap, and it is saying Nmap in it. So it is the same tool, but it is a graphical user interface. So let's get into Zenmap and see what we get it from here. So you just have to write Zenmap in the terminal, and you press enter. or you can go to the all application section and you will find the ZenMap there too. So here is the interface for ZenMap, and you can see that this section here is asking us to put a target here. So for example, my target is 192.168.0.102. You can also specify a whole network range here if you want to. For example, you want to do a whole network scan, you can just write .1/24 and it is going to scan all the 255 IP addresses for us. So right now I just want to do a single IP address scan, so I'm going to specify the target, which is this IP address, and here are the profiles. So as I told you that in ZenMap we have some default scans already made for us. So here is the list of some default scans which are available in ZenMap. So there is an intent scan, there is an intent scan plus UDP, there is a ping scan, there is a quick scan, and some other type of scan. So one thing I want to show you is, so for example, I select a ping scan here, and you can see that the command here has changed. Similarly, if we select a regular scan here, so we can see that the command here has changed. So as I told you that ZenMap is a tool which is using nmap in the background. So for example, I select a ping scan, I just copy this this command from here, I go to the terminal, I split the screen, I paste it here, and I press enter. So here is the result. So you can see that this is the same command we were using with nmap. It is just showing us in a user interface for us in ZenMap, and we can do the same thing. So if you want to specify a specific option, and if you want to add more flags or options to it, you can do it in the command section. So for now, I am going to just run a regular scan for this target IP, and this is the command here. It is just nmap and then the IP address I want to scan. So this is very easy. So these are some sections, like it is telling us the ports and topology and host details, and we are going to look into all of them after we actually complete our scan. So I will just click the scan button, and you can see that the nmap has started scanning. So for ZenMap, it is nmap which is actually doing the scanning. So this is a kind of a terminal we see in the terminal, and this is the same results we will get for nmap, but in ZenMap we are going to see it more clear and divided in sections. So it is telling me that nmap done, it took it 12.43 seconds to actually complete the scan, and these are the ports, and these are the states of the ports, and these are the services. So here in this section, you can click the ports, and you can see that we have only the port section available here, and it is actually dividing the things very clearly for us. So for example, it is telling us that there is a port 135, the protocol is TCP, the state is open, and this is the service. For example, we have specified a dash S V flag, which was a flag for the enumeration of versions, where we actually try to find the service versions. So it would have shown the version of this port of this service actually here. So we did not do that at the moment because I wanted to keep it simple, because I have already explained all the attacks or all the type of scans we can do. Here is the topology and some host details, and it is telling us that three ports are open, as we saw here, that only the three ports were open. These are some scans, like it is telling us that status is unsaved, and this was the command we actually ran. So it is very simple to run. Here is the services, it is the services which were running on the port, so we can actually click on them and find some more details on them. So this was a very, very simple scan. This was a very regular scan we did, and I actually did not go into details because I have already explained all the scans in the last video if you haven't seen it. So I want you to look into it again, and I also want you to play with Nmap or Zenmap you want to. So it totally depends on you which tool you actually want to use. But I want you to actually practice on Nmap because it's on terminal, and in the future you are going to see a lot of tools which are only terminal based, which don't have a graphical user interface, and then it will be more easy for you if you get yourself familiarized with the terminal, because terminal is very powerful, and we have already seen a lot of things which we can just do by using simple commands on the terminal. So I just wanted to show you Zenmap because some people don't like the terminal, so they can use Zenmap for scanning, and it is a great tool too. So see you guys in the next video. So now we are going to look into a type of attack which is called man in the middle attack, and if you remember from the post connection attacks, from the pre-connection attacks, where we actually made a fake AP where people were actually connecting to that AP, and we were man in the middle, and we were getting all the requests which the devices or clients which are connected to our network were sending, because we were in the middle of the network, and every packet was flowing from our device, and then we were the one who were sending it to the internet. So man in the middle attack in this section is pretty the same with the last one. The only difference is that in that attack we were actually outside the network, but in this attack we are the part of the network. So it is very effective, and it is a very dangerous type of attack. The reason is because there are not a lot of ways by which we can actually protect ourselves. And the reason for that is we are going to actually exploit the working of address resolution protocol, which is ARP. So there are two main security issues in ARP. So I'm going to explain them. First of all, I am going to read them for you. For example, it says that clients accept responses even if they did not ask for it. So for example, I connect to a network, and I did not ask router to send me to open Google for me, or I did not do anything in my network. But if any device or router tries to connect with me, or it actually sends me a packet, I am going to accept it, that there are no doubts in the process. As in, if my device, which is the hacker device, I send a packet to any other device which is connected to my network, I am going to tell them that yes, I am the router. So they are going to believe it, even if they did not ask for the router, but they are going to believe it, because this is the way ARP actually works. And each ARP request is trusted, even if it's a false request. So I am sending a false request actually. I am not the router, but if I tell any device that yes, I am the router, so that device is going to believe in me, and it is going to actually start sending the packets to me, or all the responses, all the requests to me, thinking that yes, I am the router because I told it. So this is called ARP poisoning, and this is how actually ARP protocol works. So we are going to exploit this feature of ARP. So let's look into that, how we are actually going to exploit these two flaws in ARP by controlling the flow of packets. So we are actually controlling the flow of packets by telling devices that we are the router, and then telling the router that I am the victim machine, or I am the device you should be contacting. So what, for example, there are two devices. There is a device. This is a device which is connected to the network, and this is the router. So what I am going to do is, I am going to tell this device, I am going to send a packet, and in that packet I am going to tell this device that I am the router, and this is my MAC address. So I will be sending a packet and I am going to spoof my IP, I am going to change my IP. But I did not even need to change my IP because I told you that each and every request I send to the network, it is accepted and the devices are going to believe me. So I am going to tell this device that yes, I am the router and this is my MAC address. So this, if this device wants to connect to google.com because now it believes that I am the router. So instead of sending its request to the router, it is going to send the request to me. So the meanwhile, what I am going to do is I am going to tell the router that yes, this device is me because router believes me, because this is how ARP actually works. So I am going to tell router that I am this device and this is my MAC address. So now the flow of traffic or flow of packets has actually changed. So for example, if this device wants to access google.com or bing.com, it is going to tell me that please open google.com for me because it thinks that I am the router. And now I am going to forward this request to this router and I am going to tell it that yes, please access google.com. Now that router thinks that I am this device, so it is going to send the request for google.com to back to me. And then what I am going to do is I am going to forward it back to the victim machine or to the device we actually spoofed the IP with. So this flow of the network, which was the original connection, is now compromised by me being in the middle. So I am the one who is in the middle of the attack. So I am going to explain this again a little faster. So this is a device which is connected to this router. I am going to tell this device that no, I am the router and this is my MAC address. So this device is going to believe me that yes, this I am the router. In the meanwhile, I am going to tell the router that yes, I am this device and router is going to believe me. So now every request which is being sent to the internet by this device is sent to me first and then I send it back to the router. And router send it back to me because it thinks that I am the one who has actually made that request. So it is going to send it back to me and then I am going to send it back to the victim machine. So I am the man in the middle. So this is actually the man in the middle attack means that we become the man in the middle of the attack and we are in the middle. And now we can actually see what packets they are sending and what requests they are making, because in the previous lecture when we did it with the pre-connection attacks, we did not know the network key, but now we are the part of the network and we actually know the network key and we know the decrypting key. So now we can do it with more ease and we can actually read a lot more information with this type of attack. So in the next lecture we are going to actually look into a tool and see how we can actually do it with the tool in the Kali. So now we are going to use a tool which is called ARP spoof, and it is part of a program which is called dsniff, and it is used to run MITM attacks, man in the middle attacks. So we are going to use ARP spoof to actually do the ARP poisoning or MITM attack. So there are two things, there are actually three things we are going to do in order to actually spoof the IPs. So first of all, we are going to tell the target client that I am the router. As I explained in the last video, that we are going to tell the router that I am the device, and then I am going to tell the device that I am the router. So we are following the same two steps here. So first of all, we are going to tell the target client that I am the router. And this is the command, this is very simple command. We just write in the name of the tool, the interface, and then the target IP, the target IP, and then the IP of the machine, of the router actually. So here you can see that we are saying ARP spoof, and then this is my device in the manage mode actually, then the target, then the T, and then the target IP, which is this, and then this is the IP of my AP. In the next step, we tell the AP that I am the target client. So we do
the same thing very in the similar manner. You can see that here it is API IP and then target IP, but in the next step we are going to just shift those IPs here. So in this step we are telling the API that yes, I am the target client. And in the end what we need to do is we need to enable IP forwarding. It is like, because we are going to be man in the middle, so we don't want Kali to actually drop the packets. So to do that we are going to run this command, and you can just copy paste it from here. So let's get into Kali and see how it is actually done using ARP spoof. So every time we try to use a new tool, we can just write ARP spoof, then the help for it, and you can see that it is telling me the usage. So it is telling the ARP spoof, then the interface, and then the target. So how we are going to do is, I told you we're going to write the name of the tool, then WN0, and after that the target. So this machine is going to be my target, and I can check its IP address from here. So it is 192.168.0.105, and this is the IP of my router, which is AP. So first of all, I'm going to write 192.168.0.105, which is the IP address of my target. And then the second thing I'm going to do is, I'm going to write 192.168.0.1. So this is the IP of my target, target of my AP actually, and this is the IP of my target. And I'm going to actually split the screen here, and I am going to write the same thing again. The only thing I am going to do is, I am going to just flip the IPs. So you can see that both of these commands are pretty similar. We have just in this we are going to tell the router that this is the target, I am the target device, and I am going to tell here a device that I am the target. So another thing I want you to look into is, we can say ARPA, and this is going to show me the ARP table. So for here you can see that this is the IP of my router. And here you can see that the MAC address here is 90F6526F12D2. Let me run another command very quickly, where we don't want it to actually drop the packets. So first of all, I'm going to run these two commands. I press enter, and then I press enter here, and then here I am going to paste the IP forwarding command. So now you saw here that the IP address of the router is this, and this is the MAC address of the IP, which is saved in the ARP table. Now I am going to run the ARP table command again, and I press enter, and you can see that this was the router and the MAC address for it is changed. The reason is because we ran the attack, and now ARP spoof is actually running, and the device, which is this device, it thinks that I am, which is the hacker, is the router actually. So we did it just by running two simple and similar commands. So let me actually show you my MAC address. So here you can see, here is my MAC address for WLAN 08416F9, and here in the table it is changed. So before running the attacks, you can see that the MAC address for the IP, for the AP is 90F6F2, but now after running the attack it is 8416F91E200F, which is the same MAC address of my machine. So now the device we are attacking thinks that I am the router, and router thinks that yes, I am the target machine. So we did it just by running a very simple tool, which is ARP spoof, and I just wanted to show you that how we can do ARP poisoning using ARP spoof, because it is an old tool and it is used a lot. So in the next video we're going to look into another tool, and we're going to actually use that tool in the future. It is called MITMF. So it is more easy to use. It is a terminal based tool, but we have actually more exposure to things, and we can do a lot of more crazy stuff using that tool. So see you guys in the next video.
I'm going to look into another tool which is called MITMF. It stands for Man in the Middle Framework, and it is a tool which is used to launch the MITM attacks. So we did ARP poisoning using ARP spoof in the last video, but in this video we're going to use MITMF, because MITMF gives us even more exposure, and we actually don't have to tell the router that we are the target, and tell the router that we are the target. We are the AP actually in many steps actually. So we can do in MITMF with just a single step. And you can see the command here. We can see MITMF, then the ARP, then the spoof, then we give it the gateway IP, and then we give it the target, and then the interface. So it is very simple, it is very easy to use, there is another option in MITMF that if a site is using SSLs or it is using a TLS, so we can actually bypass those two using MITMF, and in the later videos we are going to look into some advanced commands of MITMF, that how we can use our JavaScript code on some website, and how we can actually capture the keystrokes they capture, and take the screenshot and stuff like that. So for now I am just going to tell you how to ARP spoof, and how we can actually change the MAC address of the target AP in the ARP table, and then I am going to show you that how we can capture the username and password from a HTTP website which our target tries to access. So let's get into Kali, and first of all I am going to run ARPA here, and you can see that here is the IP and here is the MAC address 90F6. So I am going to run MITMF, then I am going to write ARP, then spoof, then we put the gateway, and the gateway for my AP is 192.168.0.1, then the target, and the target I am going to actually target is my host machine, which has an IP address of 192.168.0.105, so I am targeting this. And if I don't specify a target here, it is actually going to run MITMF for man in the middle attack for all the devices which are connected to the network. So for now I just want to target one device, which is my host machine, so I can say 192.168.0.105, and then I specify my interface. So if you want to put an Ethernet 0 here, you can do that too. You can actually target any interface on using MITMF. So for example, you start at the Windows 10 machine we actually installed in the lab section, where you have actually Windows 10 on a NAT network, and we can put the Kali Linux on the NAT network too, and then we specify the Ethernet 0 here, and both the devices will be on the same network, so we can run it against the ETH02. So it totally depends on you. I am using a wireless card, so I am using WLAN 0, and because my this device is on the same network as my wireless card, so it is easy for me. So you can do it for any interface you specify here. It is not just bound to a WLAN 0 or ETH0 or as many network you want to actually run the MITM for. So I press enter and MITMF is going to start for me. It is showing MITMF, the logo here. And then it is telling us that do not use a development server in a production environment. And it has now actually started for us. So now we'll go to the target machine and we can write ARPA again. And here you can see that the MAC address for router has now changed to 8416F9. And this is the target, this is the MAC address of my Kali machine, the device which I am actually running the man in the middle attack from. So now what we are going to do is, and MITMF actually when it runs, it starts a sniffer for us too. So what the device is going to do, the target device is going to do, MITMF is going to actually read it and show it on the terminal here for us. So what I am going to do is I am going to go to my browser. This is my target machine. This is the device I am actually running the man in the middle attack for. It has the IP address of 192.168.0.105. You can see here, this is the same machine. So I am going to go to a site, cfsites.org. And sometimes it can take a minute for actually pass the internet to the device. So maybe the internet is a little slow. So just you can just wait for it to load. So I have my site open here, and you can see that there is an email column here, and there is a password column here, and we can just write in any password or any email address. It is just I am not actually signed it for here. I just want to show you that how MITMF will actually going to capture this email address and password for us, which we actually write here. So I am going to write 123456 and just press sign in button here, and now we can go to Kali machine and let's wait for MITMF to actually capture the things we write on the form actually. So in MITMF can get a little slower. You can wait for 30 seconds to 1 minute and wait for MITMF to actually capture the packets it is we actually send from this machine, from the target machine actually. So here we write the email address and password, and then we come to Kali machine, and here you can see that it is telling me that this is the email address and this was the password, which was 123456, and now you can see that we were actually able to capture the email and password for that for a website which our target actually wrote. So this is just a normal working website. This is a normal machine, and the target actually do not know that he is being actually spoofed and something is wrong in the background. But here the attacker is in the middle. That we, our Kali machine is in the middle. It is telling us that the target opened a Firefox, which is a 65 version. This is the time at which they opened the site, and if you go up here, you can see that the post data, the data was sent in the post format, and the data was, this was the site which was accessed, and this was the operating system of our target, which is Windows, and this is the username for the site they actually tried to connect, which was bilal@gmail.com, and then the password was 123456. So this is just the %40 is just a browser language for at. So it is bilal@gmail.com. So you can see that how easy it is and how dangerous it is actually when we are into a network and we can just start running a sniffer and a man in the middle attack, where we can actually capture all the packets which are sending into the network and the usernames and passwords for our targets. So if we go into MITMF help, And there are a lot of things you can do with MITMF. We are going to look into some of these things, and we can see, we will see that how we can actually inject our JavaScript code in the in our target, or how we can actually make a target to open a specific HTML file and stuff like that. How we are going to capture the key, we are going to run keylogger on them, and a lot of crazy stuff. You can look into all these things, and you can also try them by yourself. I'm going to just tell you a few things in here in the next video, but for now this will be all for this video, and I hope that this is some crazy stuff I told you about right now.